Today, I thought it would be really fun to do a reading on Walter White from Breaking Bad and to show you how I would start to practice learning a new deck by doing a character analysis using tarot cards. All right, let's get started. All right, so I'm gonna shuffle these cards really, really well. And while I'm doing that, I'm going to be focusing on Walter White's character. All right, here is the spread for Walter White. The card that I got to represent him was the King of Pentacles. Now, Pentacles has to do with the earthly realm, material aspects, money, finance, physical elements of the world. So this is someone who's very rooted in the physical and not necessarily someone who is inclined to spiritual or emotional motivations. Now, Walter White embodies the King of Pentacles archetype because he is a master of whatever his chosen domain, right? From chemistry to the drug trade, he is practical, he's ambitious, and he has a relentless drive for success. He is calculated and strategic in his thinking, which is indicative of the King. Right, so we got the King of Pentacles for Walter White. And perfect card to represent him. He's so motivated by money. And this is kind of interesting because being motivated by money doesn't necessarily mean that you're evil. It's when that motivation comes at the cost of corruption. It's when that motivation or that greed eclipses other important things in your life. That's when we find the character getting derailed. Now, the pentacles mean that he is strategic and analytical in his pursuit of wealth and power, right? This is the greatest pursuit of the King of Pentacles, someone who has and needs financial security. Now, when it comes to Walter White, his pursuit of the financial security ultimately consumes him, and it really highlights the shadow side of greed and the potential to prioritize wealth over morality and human connection in his character. Now, I have a scene from the series that I thought encapsulated this perfectly, which is when Jesse Pinkman comes to him and encourages him to sell his meth recipe and basically get out of the meth drug trade business.
When you started this thing, did you ever dream of having $5 million? I know for a fact that you didn't. I know for a fact all you needed was $737,000 because you worked it all out, like, mathematically. You could spend time with your family, no more worrying about them getting hurt or finding out about everything. Isn't this what you've been working for?
I have not been working this hard just to sell out.
It's not selling out.
Yes, it is, Jesse. We have suffered and bled, literally, for this business. And I will not throw it away for nothing.
I don't know how else to say it, Mr. White. $5 million isn't nothing.
Now, his biggest challenge throughout the series, I got the Page of Wands, but when it's in the challenge position, this means I interpret this card as a reversal. So we look at the Page of Wands, but we interpret it from a negative point of view or the reverse point of view. When this is in the reversal, this means wasted potential and misuse of passion and focus. This represents immaturity, impulsivity, making poor decisions. And Walter White, his biggest challenge throughout the entire episodes is his initial insecurity and passivity, which eventually give way to his recklessness and his ego-driven decisions, right? He struggles to find his true identity and purpose. He isn't fully developed here.
And made as much money as you ever needed. It was perfect. But no, you just had to blow it up. You and your pride and your ego. You just had to be the man. If you'd done your job, known your place, we'd all be fine right now.
And he often acts on impulse rather than careful consideration. Even though he does have an analytical side to him, when he acts impulsively or rashly or through his, undeveloped emotions, he actually causes a lot of harm and he inadvertently creates more problems for himself. So this lack of self-awareness and emotional immaturity leads to destructive choices, which ultimately highlight the internal conflicts and flaws that his character struggles with throughout the entire episodes. This forefront of being someone who is a teammate and a collaborator is not a facade that Walter White chooses without consideration, right? His character focuses on building a team because he realizes that he can actually get to his goals quicker if he has a team around him.
I'm thinking maybe you and I could partner up. You want to cook crystal meth? You and me. That's right.
Now, internally, this is the part of Walter that's his true self, inside who he is, and we got the magician card. Now, I thought that this was very suiting for Walter White because the magician is also known as the alchemist or the chemist, and Walter White is literally the chemist. He's the chemistry teacher and also the meth chemist in Breaking Bad, and so I feel like the magician perfectly represents, the archetype of the magician perfectly represents his character.
Chemistry is the study of matter, but I prefer to see it as the study of change. Now just think about this. Electrons, they change their energy levels. Molecules change their bonds. Huh? Elements, they combine and change into compounds. Well, that's all of life, right? I mean, it's the constant, it's the cycle, it's solution, dissolution, just over and over and over. It is growth, then decay, then transformation. It is fascinating, really.
Someone with intention, they have purpose, they have focus, and they're very strategic and precise. The darker aspects of this archetype in Walter is that he uses his skills for deception and control, and ultimately his quest for power leads him down a path of moral corruption and pain. But again, we see the challenge card here. When I'm interpreting this spread, it's important to combine cards so that you can see the context of them together. So we take someone here who's an alchemist, who focus on manifestation and creating power, but then we add into the mix someone who is impulsive and emotionally immature and derails, and we see someone who pursues their greed and their desire for material power, even at the cost of others. So this card, I think, perfectly represents Walter White's ability to have this creative but also destructive potential within the magician archetype. So that's who he is internally. Now, for who Walter White is at the beginning of the TV series, I got the Hanged Man, which is so perfect for his character, because if we look here at this artwork, we see someone who's just hanging around. They're not moving, they're not going anywhere. But more importantly, at the very beginning of the series, Walter gets a cancer diagnosis, and it's almost like his world gets flipped upside down, like everything gets a 180. And that is the archetype of the Hangman, right? This is about surrender, sacrifice, and a pivotal pause in life. So once he is diagnosed with terminal cancer, he faces an existential crisis, right? Very much like the Hanged Man archetype. This existential crisis kind of prompts him into doing a deep introspection and a very drastic revaluation of his life. And what is his life priorities? If you get the Hanged Man in a reading, it's asking you to change your perspective, do a 180, see things upside down, right? So this is the moment of suspension between life and death that lead him to sacrifice his previous self-image and his previous ethical boundaries, and instead turn into a meth kingpin in order to secure his family's future, or so he says. Now, the Ten of Swords, for those of you that are familiar, is the most painful card in the entire deck of tarot. It is the most painful, it's the most devastating. And here at the very, very end of the series, we see Walter White come to a devastating yet inevitable conclusion. His empire has crumbled. He's been betrayed by his allies and his friends. He's isolated and defeated. This card, the Ten of Swords, is about ruin and a painful end of a cycle, betrayal and loss. So at the very end of the film, at the very end of the series, despite his initial intentions, right, despite maybe wanting to have a better life for his family or wanting different things, at the very end of the series, it's tragedy for Walter White. He has had irreversible consequences for himself and those around him. And in his final moments, he accepts his fate. And it's a painful one. The Ten of Swords is the most painful card in the deck. And at the very end of the series, Walter White's fate is incredibly marked by pain. Now, let's look at this artwork here. This definitely represents Walter White. We see a very studious academic who's standing on a mountain of books. This really encapsulates Walter White's traits of intellectual curiosity, his sharp intellect, his willingness to confront his challenges. More so, Walter White is able to be resourceful and inventive, and he's using his scientific knowledge to solve problems and outmaneuver his adversities. The Page of Swords can be very cunning, can be very complex, but ultimately is someone who is still a little bit naive at times and can still suffer from impulsive actions. So even though Walter White is incredibly smart, he's not like the King of Swords, who would be smart and mature. He's very much still the Page of Swords, who is smart, but is still naive and impulsive. And that kind of impulsive idealism is, again, something that he has challenges with. Now, what about the other characters? What is Walter White's influence on the other people around him? And for that, I got the Nine of Swords. And if we look closely at the artwork here, we see a woman who is trying to rest, she's trying to sleep, but yet she's got eyes, wakeful, anxious eyes all over her. And this card is very much representative of paranoia, anxiety, guilt, mental anguish. Anguish and struggle. So let's just go through some of the characters. So Skylar White, how she experiences this is she has many, many sleepless nights and deep anxiety as she becomes entangled in the criminal enterprise of her husband. The deeper that she gets into the meth business, the more she feels trapped and overwhelmed by her choices. For Jesse Pinkman, he experiences the Nine of Swords archetype by his guilt and his trauma. He struggles with addiction and PTSD. He has nightmares and very self-destructive behavior, all encouraged by Walter White, right? All because of situations that Walter has put him in. So this is also something that Jesse Pinkman has. Same with Hank Schrader, his brother-in-law. Hank experiences intense stress and anxiety as he pursues the investigation, and especially when he discovers his brother-in-law's involvement, right? He is obsessed. He almost has an obsessive quest for justice, and that ultimately takes a toll on his mental health, leading to panic attacks and paranoia. Again, Nine of Swords, obsession, panic attacks, paranoia, anxiety. Look at the artwork in the Eight of Swords. Now, interesting, it's a prison, right? It's a prison, it's a cage. Obviously, Walter White, as a meth kingpin criminal, he is trying to avoid prison. So if he was my client, this would definitely be something that we would talk about. We would talk about entrapment. The interesting thing about the Eight of Swords is that sometimes it's referring to a literal imprisonment, like going to jail and, of course, wanting to avoid prison. But in other ways, it can be interpreted as a metaphysical prison or a prison of the mind or a self-imposed prison of our own making. So if he was my client, and I was sitting here and I was giving him a reading, I would first analyze the artwork here and I would ask him to reflect on his feelings of entrapment. In what ways does he feel like he cannot escape this situation, right? I mean, he has cancer, he is trying to provide for his family. In many ways, even though he's been given chances to leave the meth trade, he decides to stay. And sometimes he actually makes things worse for himself so that he can't leave, right? That he can't escape. So I would encourage him to see that a lot of his feelings of self-entrapment are actually self-imposed. This card really suggests that although he might feel victimized by his circumstance, that he ultimately has the key to...
Jesse, please. I'm dying. My cancer is bad. You're not hurting anyone but my family. Okay? Look, I can't spend this money. It's not for me. I won't be around long enough to use it. It belongs to my children.
Oh, you're gonna talk about kids. You're seriously gonna go there.
I am sorry about Brock.
No, you're not.
I am.
You're not, but you're gonna be.
Yes, I am sorry about Brock. But he's alive, isn't he? He's fine, just as I planned it. Don't you think I knew exactly how much to give him? That I had it all measured out? Come on! Don't you know me by now?
I know you're lying, evil scumbag. That's what I know. Manipulating people. Messing with their heads.
Open your eyes! Can't you see that I needed you on my side to kill Gus? I ran over those gangbangers. I killed Emilio and Crazy 8. Why? I did all of those things to try to save your life as much as mine. Only you're too stupid to know it.
His own freedom, that he could step back and reevaluate his perceptions and his belief and acknowledge how his own decisions have contributed to his own predicament. Now, in the final episode of Breaking Bad, how does Walter White's personality change? How does he go from the King of Pentacles to the Queen of Wands? Now, what's interesting about this is the King of Pentacles is all about, you know, material goods, earthly goods, financial gain. And that might have been where he started from, and that might have been a key motivator throughout the series. But at the very end, he doesn't care about that anymore. I mean, he's about to die. He's got cancer. He's facing the end. And when, you know, you can't take money with you when you're gonna die. So that is obviously a place where his shift changes. Now, how I interpret court cards is they're either people or they're elements of our personality. And since, again, this is focusing on Walter White, I'm going to focus on how the Queen of Wands shows up in Walter White's personality. At the very end of the season, the very final episode, Walter White embodies the Queen of Wands through his fiery determination, his leadership, and his assertiveness. The Queen of Wands is all about someone who is confident and resourceful, and we see Walter White taking decisive action to tie up loose ends and confront his enemies head on.
Where did it come from, and why is it here?
I earned it, and you're going to give it to my children for any reason that my children do not get this money. A kind of countdown. Begin.
Right, he goes and he puts himself out there and he makes an impact, he makes a difference. Even though he's facing imminent death, his unwavering resolve and his fierce loyalty to his own vision kind of mirror the Queen of Wands' bold and independent spirit. Right, so even though he is facing failure, even though we've got the Ten of Swords at the very end of the, at the very end, right? Even though there's pain and there's suffering and failure and destruction and the consequences of his actions, he's not going to go quietly. The Queen of Wands is fiery and passionate, and she marches to the beat of her own drum. She is someone who is intensely charismatic and just almost wild. And we see that. We see that with the final scene, which, even though in the face of incredible pain, his final character, his final moments are to embody the Queen of Wands archetype here. And I think that this is really interesting. Overall, I think this was a wonderful exercise, and it's a great way to study your cards and get to know your cards on a deeper level. So now, the next time that you pull the Ten of Swords, now you have a context to apply the Ten of Swords. Again, now you have a context to apply the Ten of Swords. You know, you can think of the intense destruction and pain and the consequences and the absolute depression and anxiety at the very end of the film, right, with the Ten of Swords. And again, if you want to understand the Nine of Swords here, think of Jesse's PTSD, panic attacks. Think of all the paranoia and the anxiety and the sleepless nights, right? The Nine of Swords. So this is a great exercise to get to know your deck on a better level and to really provide context to things. Again, like the Magician, Walter White is internally the alchemist. He is the chemist. That's who he is on the inside. The Magician is the chemist, the alchemist. Now, what I always like to do at the end of readings like this is I look at the spread after I've analyzed it, and then I think, could I move any of these cards around? Could I switch any of these cards to be a different place? Like, what if the outcome was the Magician instead of the Ten of Swords? Would that make any sense in this context? And I don't think so. I don't think so at all. I mean, the outcome of Breaking Bad is not the Magician at all. It's definitely the Ten of Swords. Right, so one of the ways that I like to check myself and really just make sure that I'm feeling in alignment with the spread is, if I were to move any of this around, would it still make sense? And largely no. You know, the way that the spreads are so exact, they're so precise, that it's not really something that you can just cut and paste. Now, I had mentioned earlier the importance of the major arcana. In this spread for Walter White, I got the Magician and the Hanged Man. Now, when you're doing your analysis after you've done your spread, focusing on whatever major arcana showed up in the spread is a great way to further delve deeper into the analysis, right? These are the two pivotal kind of energies. I would say energies. These are the pivotal energies in Walter White's life, right? Being a chemist, being the Magician, being the alchemist, manifesting his vision is such a driving theme for him, but also his cancer diagnosis. The fact that in the beginning it switched. He got the cancer diagnosis and a part of his brain changed. He saw the world differently from that point on. He transformed. And this is really helpful because if you're doing readings for yourself or you're doing readings for clients, having this as an example, having to be able to pull from the experience that Walter White has as his character, if you're doing a reading and you get to the Hanged Man and you think to yourself, oh, you know what? This is an intense card. This is like getting a cancer diagnosis and it changes your view up 180 degrees. Now you have a context in which to apply the card so that you can dive in and discuss and further explore. Same with the Magician. These are very, very powerful cards in the spread. I think the other card that I really like here in terms of Walter White is, of course, the Eight of Swords. Imprisonment, confinement, entrapment, and not just entrapment because of cancer, but entrapment because of his own choices. And for those of you that are good fans of the show, you know exactly what I'm talking about. So this was a wonderful spread. And I know I went pretty quick, but I want to do another one, because I think the more of these character spreads I do, especially for those of you that are maybe still learning tarot or trying to figure out like how do you combine things together? How do you interpret a spread as a whole? This is a really great spread that I use to do character analysis with. And the more you practice the cards, the more familiar you're gonna get, the deeper the understanding that you're gonna have, and ultimately the better you're gonna be able to connect and interpret these, because you're gonna have an entire character bank that you can draw from. So it's a really great exercise, and I hope you guys do it. And if you do, please share them with me. If you have any characters that you want me to analyze, you know, leave a comment below and I'd be happy to do that. All right, thank you guys. Take care.